Well, we're Father's Day, and I know just a little bit about this, but God knows a lot. And I'm so glad that that you don't have to rely upon my knowledge completely here, but we can rely upon our God, our Heavenly Father. And so, is this doing that too? No, okay. It's my own hearing that's going in and out. All right. Well, fathers, it's a big deal. It is a huge deal. And I think that sometimes we don't understand how to deal with it, because when we begin to see the scope of what God, the responsibility God has given to fathers, it can be so burdensome. And, you know, as I read and people talk about kids and how they grow up and everything, you know, some of these studies act like, you know, moms do everything right, dads, we're the whole problem. And, well, Lisa explained that to me early on, that it was my fault, whatever it was. So I've already been established in that truth there. But if you would turn to Hebrews in chapter 13, we're going to wander around our Bible a little bit, and we're going to talk about men and fathers and leadership and families and talking about being a godly father, how important that is, not just for your family, it's important for this church. It is so necessary for this church, and it is important for our community and our culture. It's important for our society. So in Hebrews 13 and verse 17, just put a thought in our head here. This is speaking to believers, and it's talking about the authority in the church particularly, okay? But God has established an order of things. And, you know, I found that a lot of people don't believe God or trust God, that he knows what he's talking about. I mean, he spoke this universe into existence. He holds it together. But he gives us some instructions about roles and authority and how life should be. And all of a sudden, he doesn't know anything, okay? But I know that some of that's because people who are given the privilege to have certain roles, they mess it up, and that's not good. But verse 17, it says this: obey those who rule over you. All right, this concept of ruling in Scripture is talking about servant leadership, and it means to lead. And this is the kind of leadership we saw in the Lord Jesus Christ as he walked. So we look at the perfect man, the one who is exalted to the heavens and given the name that's above every name, so that everyone bows and everyone confesses that Jesus Christ is Lord. That means he's the boss, okay? All power, which means authority in Matthew 28, is given to me, he said. And so all this authority is given to him. He is Lord. And we are, he's the great shepherd of the sheep. Those of us who lead are under shepherds. We're under the shepherd leading. And the admonition here is obey those who rule over you, those who lead you, those who God has placed in authority over you. And be submissive. For they watch for your souls as those who must give an account. They have a responsibility. They have an accountability. And the verse goes on to say, let them do so with joy and not with grief, for that would be unprofitable for you. Now, I know it's talking about the church, but church leadership is predicated on the home. Okay, so men who lead in the church are supposed to have their houses in order. And not perfect, but in order. They're supposed to learn leadership in their homes, and then they lead in the church. But if we can apply this as a general statement, and I believe we can, if God put somebody, you know, I mean, ladies, don't you want this to be true about you? You want your kids to just listen to what you say. I said, pick up your room. Just do what I say. And if they back talk or whatever, it gives you grief, doesn't it, ladies? It makes your life more difficult, right, ladies? And if they would just do what you tell them to do the first time, life would be wonderful. You would have joy. It's the same way about anyone in a position of leadership. And it's something very true about the leadership that God has given to the men. Okay? Men, God holds you responsible. Okay? And so you want things to run smoothly. And so you could give me an amen on this is true. You would like a little cooperation sometimes. Amen. All right. Yeah, I knew that was there. We make, all of us, make life more difficult for ourselves sometimes when we buck authority that is godly authority and right authority. I'm not saying that there's not ungodly authority. There are people to do that. But as God designed it, we make life more difficult for ourselves. And that's why he says this would be unprofitable for you. In Ephesians in chapter 5, this is a wonderful chapter that deals with God's order in things and what it means to be filled with the Holy Spirit. And it talks about the basic unit of a home, and that's a husband and a wife, okay? A husband and a wife. And talking particularly here, this is not the sermon is not going to be from here, but if you would look at verse 33, that happens to be the last verse in chapter 5 of Ephesians. It says, "Nevertheless, let each one of you in particularly so love his own wife as himself." That's the admonition to the man, the husband. "And let the wife see that she respects her husband." Okay, ladies, you don't have to like us or... you're supposed to love everyone, even your enemies. But what God says the husband needs is respect. You know, I'm not going to break into a Aretha Franklin song or anything, but I heard that a man wrote that song. So I can see a man in his heart crying out, "How about this is a hard job? How about a little respect now and then?" And that is not only good for the man; it's necessary for the man, but it's good for all those who are under his authority as he's accountable to God. So we are talking today about men and being a godly man, and I want to give you a little glimpse of that from the Psalms. And so let's go back to Psalm 15. And thankfully, you know, this is just a little psalm and we can just read it quickly together. But follow along as I read this and see if we can gather some information from what God is talking about how people should be. This is Psalm 15, a psalm of David. "Lord, who may abide in your tabernacle? Who may dwell in your holy hill?" Now, David is a man who is under the law. His method and place of worship God was the temple in Jerusalem, and there were steps to approach that, weren't they? Literally, there were steps, and that was a picture of the whole idea that man had to go through a lot of the things prescribed by God to approach him. But who could not only approach, who could dwell there? Who would be in fellowship with God? Who could walk with God Almighty? It says, verse 2, "He who walks uprightly." You know, the illustration here is that your life is vertical. That means that you're looking to God and in connection with him. But walking uprightly, you won't be a problem to other people. You know, if if you were in a crowd moving into a, let's say, a stadium, okay, because we don't have crowds moving into churches too much. But if you're moving into a stadium and say you want to lean this way, you know, and then you're going to cause problems from people on this side. Well, let's say you want to lie down. So people are going to trip over you, aren't they? The illustration is to walk upright, and that way that people can follow you, and you're living a godly, upright, holy life. He who walks uprightly and works righteousness and speaks the truth in his heart. So righteous deeds and integrity of the heart. Someone who is honest. Now, this is something that God desires, and this is the life of his son, and this is what he produces in us who believe him and trust and yield to him. He who does not backbite with his tongue. You don't want to criticize and talk back, we just saw it in the context of Hebrews, you know, when I guess that doesn't work very much in the military, does it? You know, the sergeant barks some orders, you don't bite back or you're in trouble. God says, let's don't talk behind people's back. Let's don't criticize unnecessarily. Nor does evil to his neighbor. We need to be kind to one another, don't we? Nor does he take up a reproach against his friend. Boy, that's really terrible, huh? To betray a friend. In whose eyes a vile person is despised, but he honors those who fear the Lord. I think we can, you know, who are our heroes? That kind of is something. Who is it that we admire? Are we admiring somebody who maybe is a great athlete, but their family life or their character is undesirable? You know, we need to be careful, because God says, you know, the upright we should put our eyes upon. And I'm talking about this, so I'm going to tie this together for us in just a second here. It says, he who swears to his own hurt and does not change, you make a promise and you keep it, even if it's not to your advantage after a while. You know, I said I'd do it. I'd rather not now, but I promise, so I'm going to keep my word. He who does not put out his money at usury, in other words, collecting interest on somebody, a friend or somebody who's in need and needs some help, you know, taking advantage of their problem. Nor does he take a bribe against the innocent. He is just, fair. He who does these things shall never be moved. And so here's a little summary in the scripture there of what God says is a godly man. And this is what a man should be. And when we are how we should be, we understand something, a principle of why it's so important. Because all of us are, our lives are a sermon. All of us are an example. Now, the Apostle Paul says, follow me. Now, that's a brave statement, isn't it? Follow me. You know, he's like, I know where I'm going. Follow me. He qualifies it. And when he was writing to the Corinthians, he says, follow me as I follow Christ. Now, if we can find our way back to the book of the Ephesians and chapter 4, I want you to, it's worth thinking about an example. Look what God points out here for us. I meant chapter 5. I think I said 4, didn't I? Okay. Chapter 5, verse 1. Therefore, be imitators of God as dear children. And that's something, be imitators of God as dear children. What's the example there? What is the picture that he's giving us? You know, it's so baffling to me sometimes, Dad, where I'll be talking or say something and I hear your voice coming out of my mouth. It's just, and I didn't do that on purpose. I'll find myself doing some things, you know, like get home from work and plop down on the couch and turn the TV on. Where did I learn that? I don't even think about some of these things. Maybe I should, but I find myself imitating my Father, and I don't do it consciously. But God is saying, you have a heavenly Father, and as a child will imitate his parent, you should imitate your heavenly Father. You should follow him. I'll read you a little story here. And dads, we decide what kind of role model we're going to be for our children, for our grandchildren. It's such a wonderful task. I want to read to you a story here that Paul Harvey gave one time. And he says, our For What It's Worth department knows that when Gray Barker goes golfing in Jackson, Mississippi, he has taken his three-year-old grandson Trevor along as a companion. The boy has been watching and learning from his grandfather about the game of golf. Last week, Grandpa Baker bought the lad a set of play golf clubs for his very own. Well, this past weekend, during a family cookout in the backyard, the little lad who'd learned golf by observing Grandpa announced, watched me. And so he took out his little set, and he said a no-no word, and threw his golf club up in the pear tree. Now, can you see that? You can see that. Grandpa was not trying to teach him to curse and throw his golf clubs, but the little boy was just observing, and that's what he saw, and that's what he learned. I respect Grandpa. This is the way Grandpa does it. It must be right. I should do that. You say, wait. The Pharisees, you know, were example that Jesus said in Matthew 23. Do what they say, don't do what they do. We think we're going to do that. Okay, you just do what I say, don't do what I do, but it doesn't happen that way. We, especially children, as we're growing up, we learn from the example that is set before us, and we do what we see. That becomes a pattern of life. And men, that is a real pressure on you, isn't it? Say, yes, it is. I know it is. And I've seen it in my children. I've been pleased at some things. Well, they picked up some good things that maybe they saw that in me or their mother, you know, most likely their mother. But and then I've seen some reactions to situations that said, I've reacted like that before. I wonder if they got that from me, watching me. That's a big responsibility. And I've said before that the Christian life is not hard. The Christian life is impossible. But I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And being a godly father is impossible. Okay? But we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. That's the wonderful part of it. We don't have to do this alone. Now, I can speak from years of experience, you know, and wisdom and gray hair and all that, and I can say that, you know, I've learned that I'm not perfect and my father wasn't perfect and I've never met anyone who's perfect. I know that I can observe good things in a person and I can seek to emulate those good things, and I can learn from bad examples, and I can reject those for my own life as a way to live. As an adult, I can do that. But as a child, we don't have that capacity. As a child, we can say, you know, something, I'll never be like that. You know, I remember a relative who would try to get his dad to stop smoking and stop smoking and stop smoking, and he would give him such a hard time. He would hide the cigarettes. He would tear them up. He would do all kinds of things. I thought his dad was going to kill him. But he was trying to get his dad to stop smoking. You know what? When this guy became a teenager, he started smoking, and here he is still smoking, you know, 40 years later. You know, that's just an example. There are a lot of other things, aren't there, that, you know, we have a tendency as children, even if we don't like something, to follow an example. Children don't have the same capacity to filter that we do, and that's why it's so important that we walk uprightly. The whole idea of being a man in God's mind and in his plan is that we live for others. That's the whole deal. As men, we have to take into account those around us because we are here for them. That's the way God designed it. If you don't like that, take it up with him. You know, it's not my idea. I would have figured out another way. But God says, no, it's you, man. It's you. You need to walk with me because somebody is following you. And you don't want to lead them on some wild goose chase. You don't want to lead them into dangerous territory. You're here to protect them. You're here to guide them into truth. You're here to be a godly example for them. And it's easier for you to do that, right, when you get a little respect. But don't forget, respect, it is earned. And when we say walk in our integrity, it doesn't mean walk in your perfection. And I think that this is something that, you know, maybe we would all think about it, talking to the elders the last few weeks, talking about things. And elders, we're called to be blameless. And somebody might misunderstand that and say, well, elders are perfect. Well, not in your life they are. But blameless means that we, when we make a mistake, we go about in a biblical manner to correct that and make it as right as we can with the people that we've wronged, so that people can't accuse us of doing something wrong and not fixing it. Blameless means you're restored to that person you wronged as much as lies within you. And it's with our children, with our grandchildren, they're not looking for perfection. They don't really need it from us. They have it in Christ. They don't need it from us. What they need is honesty. And I'm so glad that, you know, that they can learn some lessons from our mistakes. But we have to communicate and we have to teach them. So, the wonderful thing about being a Christian is we have God with us to help us. The wonderful thing about being a father is he's there too. He knows how it works. He knows what to do, and he provides the grace and the strength. And the foolishness is to try to go it without him. That's the foolishness of the whole thing. And I hope that you will have a great day today, fathers. I hope that you'll get love and respect that people will see in spite of your, you know, the scratching in public when you places you didn't scratch or belching or whatever you do that makes you a man, you know, that there are good things in your life and you've tried. And as far as I pray to God that you would get some respect today and that would encourage you to press on with the good fight and run the race that God has given you. It is so important. You know, a lot of you know this, some of your grandparents, and that's why you understand it's none of the successes of life mean very much at all unless our children grow up and walk with God. And so I know that's the prayer of our hearts. That's what really matters, is that our children know the Lord Jesus Christ and walk with him enjoy his blessings. So God, give us that, the desires of our heart, and let's pray together.